What is an integral? It is a mathematical formalism invented to calculate the area under a curve. And the basic idea of partitioning random shapes into rectangles and triangles has existed since ancient times. However, the integral as we know today was invented by Newton and Leibniz, which uses rectangles to approximate the area. And as we make each rectangle infinitesimally thin, then we would get the exact area under the curve. And we use right rectangles here, but we could instead use the left rectangles or the midpoint rule to find the area. And once we take the limit, the area should approach the exact same value. And roughly speaking, this condition that the limit approaches the same value no matter how we choose our rectangles is called Riemann integrability. But chances are, you probably have never seen the formal definition of Riemann integrability in your classes. In elementary calculus, every function you encounter are automatically Riemann integrable. So there's no need to go into abstract details. And in a typical course in introductory analysis, we frequently skip the Riemann's definition. But instead, we learn the Darboux integrability, which is theoretically equivalent to the Riemann's, but it is better in almost every ways. So what exactly is wrong with Riemann's definition of integrals, and why is it so unpopular in our education system? The first attempt at rigorously defining calculus began with Bolzano's definition of limit, which formalized the notion of approaching a value as we get close enough from all sides using formal logic. Then, using this new idea of limit, Cauchy formally defined what a derivative is. And there are alternate definitions that we use today, but they're not exactly different since we can get them from change of variables. The first formal definition of the integral was invented about a half a century later by Riemann. Then soon after, Darboux came up with his own version. Then Lebesgue came up with a completely new way to define the integral. Now, as for what these definitions are, the Riemann and Darboux integrals are two distinct, rigorous definitions of an idea originally invented by Newton and Leibniz, which is to approximate the area under a curve by dividing the region into rectangles and progressively reducing the width of each rectangle. Then, as for the Lebesgue integral, we measure the total length of a function at each height to calculate the area. And if the function does not have discrete heights, then we can digitize the function into discrete heights. Then, as we increase the number of heights, the limit converges to the exact area. Now, as fascinating as Lebesgue integrals are, the rest of the video will focus on the left side. First, we will start with the generalized Riemann sum. Unlike the way we do it in elementary calculus, we can partition the region from A to B into non-uniform lengths. And the collection of these subdivisions is called the partition P. Now, for each of these subinterval, we can sample a point inside the interval to determine the height of each rectangle. And these samples are called tags. And in elementary calculus, we typically tag the left endpoint of each interval, or the right, or the midpoint. But in the context of generalized Riemann sum, tags can be chosen arbitrarily. Now, we typically call the partition along with the tags the tagged partition, labeled P star. Now, putting this in proper jargon, the Riemann sum of a function f with the particular choice of a tag partition P star is the sum over all heights, which is f evaluated at the sample point, times the width of each rectangle, delta, which is the difference of two consecutive partition points. Now that we have the Riemann sum, we are ready to define the formal definition of Riemann integrability as Riemann originally defined. We can first define the norm of a partition, which is simply the length of the biggest subinterval. Then we say a function is Riemann integrable on the interval a to b if the limit of the Riemann sum approaches a particular value whenever the norm or the biggest subinterval approaches zero. And we call that limit the Riemann integral of f from a to b. Now, to build some intuition for this definition, it says that regardless of how we partition the interval from a to b, and no matter how we sample the points, as long as the subintervals become sufficiently thin, the limit should converge to the exact area under the curve. Now, to truly understand the meaning of this, we want to examine a case where the limit fails to exist. Let's take a quick look at this example to review the most common technique to prove that a limit does not exist. The limit of this two-variable function as the order pair x and y approaches the origin does not exist. And in order to show that, the limit along the positive x-axis is 1. And the limit along the positive y-axis is 0. And if we can demonstrate that the limit could approach at least two different values along two different paths, then the limit does not exist. And this more or less is the technique that we use to prove that a function is not Riemann integrable. So let's take a look at this function, which takes the rational inputs to 1 and irrationals to 1/2. Then for any partition, no matter how thin they are, we could choose to tag either a rational or an irrational. In particular, it is always possible to sample a rational point for each subinterval, even if each rectangle becomes infinitesimally thin, because the rational numbers are a dense subset of the real numbers. And similarly, it is possible to always tag an irrational point for each rectangle. So the limit as the width of the thickest rectangle approaches 0 could approach at least two different values, depending on how we choose to sample our points. So this is an example of a non-Riemann integrable function. So far, this definition doesn't seem too bad, but it does indeed become a cosmic horror to show the integrability of some of the simplest functions, such as x cubed. And to make the problem a little easier, let's set the limits of the integration, a and b, to be non-negative numbers. And if you didn't sleep in your elementary calculus class, you already know what the supposed limit is. So, can we prove it from the Riemann's definition of integrability? First, we can create an arbitrary partition from a to b with n subintervals. Then, we can choose arbitrary tags for each of these subintervals. Then, the Riemann sum of the tagged partition should approach the supposed limit as the norm of the partition approaches 0. And instead of solving for this limit directly, it is easier to prove that the difference approaches 0. Now, we are ready to tackle the problem. First, we will take the absolute value so that the expression is going to be greater than or equal to 0. Next, we are going to make some substitution, so we will do some scratch work on the side. A is the leftmost partition point, and B is the rightmost partition point. So we have this equality. And this is equal to the summation of the difference of fourths of the partition points, because this is a telescoping sum, meaning every term cancels out except for the very first and the very last. So we can make our first substitution. And the difference of fourths can factor into a linear and a cubic. We made this completely counterintuitive substitution so that we can combine the two summations into one. Next, the absolute value of the sum is less than or equal to the sum of the absolute values. And this is called the triangle inequality. And if you have never seen it before, if we add a bunch of numbers, positives and negatives can potentially cancel each other out. But if we make each number positive first, then each number adds up constructively. Next, we are going to condense our notation a little. Then we can pull out the length of each subinterval from the absolute value since it is a positive number. Then we are going to factor out 1/4. And since there is a 4 copy of the tag cube, we can pair it up with each term of what's being subtracted. Next, we will apply triangle inequality again on each of the differences. Next, we are going to do some more scratch work on the side. Cubing preserves the ordering. And in particular, the tag point cube should always sit in between the partition points cubed. Now, let's call the difference of two partition points cubed delta x sub I cubed. Then, the distance from the tag cube to each of the partition point cube should add up to the delta cube. So, we have the following two inequality, which says that the distance between the tag cube and any partition point cube is at most delta cubed. Now, a small number cubed is less than the small number squared times the big, which is less than the small times the big squared, which is less than the big cubed. So both of these multiplicative combinations must sit somewhere in between the partition points cubed. And the distance between these two numbers and the tag cubed is clearly less than delta cubed, no matter what the tag is. So we have these two inequalities. Now that we have these four bounds, we can go back to the original problem. And each of these absolute values are less than or equal to the delta of cubes, Then, we can cancel 4 with 1/4. Now, each of these delta is less than or equal to the maximum possible delta, which is the norm of the partition. And the norm is independent of the index of summation, so we can pull it out of the sum. And lastly, the summation of delta cube telescopes, leaving only the first and the last term. And pretty much all of the heavy lifting is done. So, we started from the difference between the generalized Riemann sum and the supposed limit, and we have a reasonable upper bound on this expression. Now, if we take the limit as the norm of the partition goes to zero, the right expression goes to zero. And since the absolute value is always greater than or equal to zero, the original expression must also go to zero. And this proves that the function x cubed is indeed Riemann integrable from a to b using the definition. This definitely is not an easy proof for such an elementary result. And one issue with this definition is that we were required to know in advance what the limit was supposed to be. And our biggest difficulty came from the fact that the limit has to exist for all possible combinations of partitions and tags. So maybe we could find a better way to do this. So for any partition, let's take a look at just one subinterval. Then we can possibly choose a tag that maximizes the height of the rectangle, or minimize it. Then we have the upper sum of a partition, which is the sum of the biggest possible rectangles for each subintervals. And similarly, we can define the lower sum. But there is a slight problem with this definition. What if the function has a discontinuity like this, so that it's actually impossible to get the maximum height? In particular, this function can take on any heights from 1/2 to 1, excluding 1. So the minimum exists, which is equal to 1/2, but the maximum does not exist. We can sample a height arbitrarily close to 1, like 0.999 repeating finitely many times, but we can't actually attain the height of 1. So maybe it's appropriate to extend our definition a little. And the supremum is the perfect man for the job. Roughly speaking, supremum is the extended version of maximum so that it's guaranteed to exist. And we also have the infimum, which is the generalized minimum. As per their formal definitions, it's fairly technical, and it doesn't matter too much in the grand scheme of what we are trying to achieve, so I will leave a link in the description below. So we can allow ourselves to sample the height of 1, and we can redefine the upper sum and the lower sum using the supremum and the infimum respectively. So for any given partition, there are all sorts of ways that we can tag it. And the upper sum is the supremum of all the Riemann sums of that partition, and the lower sum is the infimum. So we have the following inequality, which gives us an upper and a lower bound for every Riemann sum of a given partition. So from here, we can just take the limit of the upper and the lower sum, which are guaranteed to exist, which I will explain why later. And if these two limits are equal to each other, then the limit of the sandwiched value should also converge to the same value. This is a significant improvement, since the right side is much easier to compute because we are taking limits over all partitions, but just two different tags for each partition. But they still are difficult limits to compute, so maybe we can make some further improvements. So, given any function, what is the worst upper sum that we could take? Well, if we take a partition with just one subinterval, then the upper sum is as big as possible. Now, if we subdivide our partition, then the upper sum is smaller than the original, and it is a much better estimate. So, if we continue to make refinements on our partition, then the upper sum will continue to decrease. So the limit of the upper sum as each subinterval gets infinitesimally thin should approach the infimum of all upper sums. We have some basic intuitions as to why this has to be the case, but as for a formal proof, it doesn't belong in this video, so I will leave a write-up of the proof in the description below. And if you happen to know some general topology, the proof is an immediate consequence of the monotone convergence theorem for nets. And similarly, the limit of the lower sums should approach the supremum of all lower sums. So once we make the final substitution, we have the definition of Darboux integrability, which is equivalent to the Riemann's definition. And in modern language, we would call these two values the upper integral and the lower integral respectively. Now, the first question we should ask is, how much better is this new definition? So let's try slaying the same monster with our new blade. First, let's define a family of partition Pn to be n equal sized partition, just like how we do it in elementary calculus. Then the upper sum of Pn is exactly the same as right sum, since the function is always increasing. As per the evaluation of the summation, you could first expand the cubic, then apply the summation formula for each power. But I'm not going to compute this by hand. It's a little hard to see what's going on, so let's expand it. The first two terms should look familiar. And everything else is left over from our overestimate. Notice how each of these terms are over n or n squared. So the summation evaluates to the difference of fourths over 4, plus some additional stuff that decays at the rate of 1 over n. And the lower sum should be same as the left sum. And the lower sum evaluates to the almost same value. But this time, we took an underestimate, so we have a minus on the additional stuff. Now, the lower integral is the supremum of all underestimates, so it's no more than the infimum of all overestimates, which is less than or equal to any old overestimate, including the upper sums of our equipartition. And similar story for the lower sum. So the difference between the upper and the lower integral should be less than or equal to the difference between the upper and the lower sum of our equipartition, with their difference on the order of 1 over n. Now, this has to hold for all values of n, no matter how big n is. So once we pass it to the limit, 1 over n goes to 0. So the upper and the lower integral has to be the same value. That was so much easier than the Riemann's definition. First, we didn't have to know the answer to begin with. And secondly, most of the techniques used here are introduced at a high school level, since we were working mostly with equality instead of inequality, and the summation was significantly more concrete. Now, there are many theorems regarding integrability. And these two theorems trivialize the problem that we just solved in this video. As per their proofs, they're proven using the Darboux definition. Earlier, I mentioned how in order to prove the integrability directly from the Riemann's definition, you had to know what the limit is beforehand. But that is pretty much impossible for these two theorems, because we don't even have a specific function. So the Riemann's definition is pretty useless in most cases. Between the two equivalent definitions, we use the better one and frequently ignore that the other one ever existed. But from a purely pedagogical standpoint, we probably needed to speedrun the early game content in order to unlock the real game as soon as possible.